What's up, Collider TV Talk fans? Here for a special Get That Spoiler Alert review up there. It's time to talk some Iron Fist. Got some special guests here. Our resident hero, always here to break down these Marvel Netflix shows. John Schnepp's here. What's up, John?
Hey, what's up, Josh? Happy to be a part of the movie TV Talk Heroes combo unit. So
it's this nice synergy we have when these Marvel Netflix series.
Yeah, definitely. We did it the last couple. So we did Luke Cage. We did Daredevil. We're going to rock some Iron Fist.
Heck yeah. And as always, my co-host every Monday here on Collider, TV Talk, he's our Luke Cage. Ladies and gentlemen, David Griffin.
Yeah, what's happening? Hey, to be here. Yeah. Christian just walked in. He's got some Hogwarts sweatpants on. Where do you get those sweatpants? They look comfy.
Pottersville.
Potter'sville. Yeah.
You get them in Kun Lun. They seem to wear whatever. That's seems to be like a trash bag.
They're both magical places.
Hobo sweaters and stuff.
Yeah.
Kun Lun.
They haven't done laundry in Kun Lun since the 14th century, but that's okay.
Yeah. You think you just like just leave it out in the freezing snow and it'll just instantly get.
There's snow and then all of a sudden there's trees. Regardless, it seems like this has been by far the most divisive series of the Marvel TV universe, especially on Netflix. When it came out, and I will say I was part of the critics that were in the first six episodes, right? I didn't put my opinion anywhere because I wanted to talk to the TV Talk team first and you guys, well, everybody that didn't have those first six episodes to watch. I was a very hot and cold all through this entire series. I think Luke Cage, because this was Luke Cage, obviously was the one right before this that had more hot moments than this did. I think Luke Cage kind of petered out a little bit. I feel like Iron Fist crescendoed at certain points. But I will say this is no Daredevil. It's no Jessica Jones. And I know a lot of people are like, you hated Jessica Jones. There was parts of Jessica Jones that I really did not like, but I thought Jessica Jones flowed a lot better than this one. Now, I'd get your honest opinion. Overall, how do you feel about the series?
You know, overall, I feel it's almost the opposite of Luke Cage. I feel like Luke Cage had like an incredible first six episodes and then kind of petered out a little. It was still great. The last seven episodes were still really fun.
Absolutely.
Just didn't have that impact that the first six did.
Yeah.
Iron Fist, for me, I had the opportunity to see those six episodes like a couple, like a month ago too. Yeah. And I decided, no, I'm just going to watch all of it at once.
Yep.
And I'm glad I did that because to me, it's the opposite of Luke Cage where the first, like, I'd say five episodes of Iron Fist, it could have just been one episode.
100%.
It was so slow and draggy, and scenes just kept going. You're like, why are they still in that office room? Get out of there already. Or why are they still talking about the same thing? I'm bored out of my mind.
Corporate litigation?
Yeah, I'm going to pass out, move on with the story. Can we get to a story? So that's literally the first 5 hours I felt really kind of like tied down in like this, oh, when is it going to get started? There are a couple of cool action sequences that happen. I think it was episode 3 and 5. There were some cool sequences. And then for me, at least, it really started to move episode 6, 7, once they got into the hand and a lot of elements with back and forth betrayal and the family betrayal and all these kinds of things. So then it actually started to get interesting to me. So I felt like the, you know, episodes 7 through 13 are really the ones that if I was going to suggest anything, I'd say don't watch episode 1 through 5. Just start with 6. Like that's the first episode.
Sure.
It doesn't even matter. You're not going to miss anything. You're missing very little. Like Danny Rand running around like, I don't know where I am. And like garbage clothes.
You should like me.
Yeah. You don't need to see him crying and whining about like he needs to be get his, you know, $1 billion company back from a bunch of rich people. It's like, who cares? None of that stuff really matters. You could literally skip all 5 episodes, start with episode 6, and you will be caught up. I trust you that you're smart enough to understand the boring parts that you missed. You really aren't missing anything. Yeah. I would even say watch episodes 6 through 13, and then if that little gremlin is like, you got to go back and watch, go ahead and watch the other 5. So you'll be like, oh, okay, I missed that part. But you really don't need it.
Right, I'm with you. David Griffin, how are you feeling right now?
I thought this whole show was just a misfire.
Yeah.
It was really sad, too. And I say that, you know, before you go in the comments, be like,
here we go.
I'll show David something. Here we go. I don't think the show is a complete failure. I don't think it's all bad. There are some great moments in this series. I completely agree. But for me, this could have been the most fun show in the whole franchise. Like they don't need all their characters to be, you know, dark and brooding. You know, they don't all have to be Batman. I know they all have tragic past. Peter Parker has a tragic past.
Yeah.
But you can have, you know, you can still be a fun character, just kind of enjoy to watch him fight. And they could have had all these cool martial arts action sequences. This is Kung Fu. Yeah. Be John Wick. Be The Raid.
Yeah.
Be completely over the top. And I thought the fights were dull. compared to Daredevil.
I felt like a lot of the fights felt the same.
Yeah, I know it's not fair to compare it to the Raid. The Raid is considered one of the greatest action, you know, fight sequences of all time. So I know that's not fair. Sure. That's like Michael Jordan top level. But still, it's like I feel like they could have implemented some of that, and they could have had so much fun instead of this whole show about corporate litigation and financial takeovers. You know, it's like these actors use them for something else. It just felt like it was a misfire. But again, it's not all bad. I had fun in certain parts. I agree. There's some episodes. Episode 6 was a good episode.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Getting specifically, like, you know, Madame Gao was escorting him from room to room, having him to fight a
that
different
character.
It's almost like a video game scene. Yeah. It's like, here's
the
villain
here.
Oh, that
felt like Tekken.
Yeah. Yeah. And every time, speaking of which, my favorite thing, every time Madame Gao was on screen, I was focused. She's so good. Yeah.
Like, if we're going to talk about positives and negatives, obviously it feels like we're bashing it right now. But if we're talking positives of the show, Madame Gao was incredible, and she was really great in Daredevil too. Mm-hmm. Do you know what I mean? She has a great presence on screen. The one thing I was really disappointed about, and this has always been my thought process when you're doing things with like telekinesis or anything like that. There's one point where Madame Gao does like a thing and like pushes people. Right.
So she just like put her hand up.
Yeah,
and he goes and then flying, just like flying. Yeah.
Saw that. One time.
Yeah.
One time.
I was waiting for her to do it again, and then she never does it again.
Never does it again. Yeah. So why?
And she keeps, I think they're saving it. Because remember in season one of Daredevil, is it Stitch? I'm getting his name wrong.
Stick.
Stick goes
Lilo
and sees.
Lilo and Stick.
Yeah, Stick goes and sees his master.
Yeah.
And Madame Gao talks about her master. There's somebody above them that's at a higher level in the hand that we haven't seen yet. I think maybe we saw him at the end of Daredevil season one.
We may see
I think they're saving him. Yeah. I think
that's what
he is. He's like the Thanos.
I was
going to
say, what is his girlfriend's name?
Colleen Wing.
Colleen Wing
was
incredible.
Yes.
She was great.
So, I mean, every time she was on screen, stunning, amazing fighter.
Those first four or five episodes, the best part was when she was doing the Fight Club stuff.
Yes.
And she was beating the shit out of those huge dudes.
Yeah, the Fight Club stuff was. I was going to say, if you got rid of all of the garbage lawsuit, lawyer, like, I want to be part of Rand again, boring stuff that really was inconsequential when you look at the overall story arc, doesn't matter. When you really look, you could take all those scenes out
100%.
And you might have 4 hours of amazing sequences with Iron Fist coming to find out why he was, you know, mind blanked and get his revenge on the hand, and then realize the hand is like, you know, two secret, you know, agencies running parallel to each other. All that kind of stuff was great. I love the Drunken Master fight scene.
Drunken Master fight scene.
Yeah, I mean, that was
awesome.
That was episode 8 when they went to China. That was a good,
yeah that was an homage to Jackie Chan, that kind of drunken fighting style. Mm-hmm. I love that. I love seeing a lot of these fight scenes. I have to say, some of the fight scenes were incredibly well choreographed. Yeah. The final fight scene with Colleen and her master, the revenge on the hand character.
Yeah.
I thought a lot of those sequences were really well done. Yeah, it's no Raid. It's not a big budget movie style.
But it wasn't Daredevil either.
No, it was not. I agree. They got to step up on the next one. I think Defenders hopefully will have some of the best action scenes.
Right.
That I'm at least,
same showrunners from Daredevil season 2.
Yeah, someone told me that as well. I was like, look, I'm looking forward to Defenders. Iron Fist didn't make me like hate on the idea of the Defenders.
Yeah.
I just felt like out of all of the series so far, Iron Fist was definitely the weakest link.
Yeah.
So.
Well, I think also too is we've been anticipating this so much because the other three have been so good.
Right.
And you know, I mean, listen, I've had my faults with Jessica Jones, and people will destroy me in the comments whenever. I just felt like Jessica Jones was such a departure from Daredevil a little bit, and I was expecting so much, you know, after Daredevil. Luke Cage was exactly what I thought Luke Cage would be, and they had an homage to his first outfit,
right?
They did nothing for Iron Fist as far as like any of the costuming, anything like that.
We did have the green and yellow robe. When the Kunlun like flashbacks, he had the robe, but it was it's not like the full.
And speaking
full
of Kunlun, like we barely saw Flash.
That was an issue I had because they're trying to get us to like really care about his backstory.
Right,
he's been in this place for 15 years. Madame Gao even says she names.
If they showed that mom flying to the plane one more time. I was
well, not
my
that
mind.
Yeah, no, but I mean, Madame Gao mentions this tree, and she's like, "Why would you leave heaven?"
Right,
like basically saying this place is like perfect. You know, even though obviously he was getting beaten as a kid, he was getting going through some rough things. We could have seen some scenes with him in Kunlun to be like, oh, I can see why you'd want to stay there. I can see why somebody, why would they leave? Like, we never saw anything.
So underdeveloped. Like, we had no connection to his past. So henceforth, we don't really care about his future because they're not giving us anything to
care
about.
Can I speak
about.
Of another character that's past I like Davos.
Yeah.
I liked him. I wish he would have come in earlier.
Davos
but I liked
hanging
Davos.
Out with Claire Temple, and he was like, "You're a very gifted healer." Like, that was really fun.
He tried the pizza. He's like, "It's a little chewy."
Yeah,
it's a little chewy. I like Davos.
Davos had a pretty good storyline. Obviously, you know, at the end with Madame Gao, you know, here's the thing. It felt like he left Kun Lun. He came to New York. They sent Davos. And even if he doesn't leave with Davos, it's like, well, but then we get there at the end and Kun Lun is destroyed, right?
Right, right.
Well, yeah. But we don't care because we've never seen it.
Yeah, it doesn't matter.
So we don't know where it went.
Yeah, and it's missing. So what?
Yes.
Yeah.
We never saw it. We never saw the beauty of Kun Lun. We never saw, like, we get up there and like, oh, it's gone. Well, we didn't know what it looked like in the first
magical place. How could you leave easily? Yeah. Never saw it. You
yeah. know? And well, he's, yeah. It felt like, and his origin story is him getting it from a dragon. All we saw was red eyes. That's it. Listen, I understand dragons are really tough to make, but there could be a really cool origin story. And what they've done in Luke Cage, what they did in Daredevil, what they did in Jessica Jones.
Yeah, there was always an episode that was an origin story.
Always an origin episode.
Yeah. They did not have that in this. Yeah. And in fact, it feels like they cheaped out on a lot of things that they shouldn't have.
Yeah.
Where it's like, look, you could have spent a little bit more money on getting this magical city right.
Right.
You could have spent a little bit more money on getting the whole idea of the actual Iron Fist and the chi and centering your energy. Like, I liked all the ideas of it because even though it's magical, they start to get into that Doctor Strange territory where the city's every couple of years disappearing and things like that. But they never really broach it. And it stays like, well, one guy returns from the dead. You know what I mean? It's like, literally, there's a lot of elements of magic, but they're just done in a really awkward way. So it makes it like, I liked his inability to control his chi. Like, it was because he couldn't focus. He was so unfocused that it was ruining his sort of like all his of acting. His training. Yeah. Yeah.
I think his acting. Also, too, I think for me, I wish Rosario Dawson. I think she deserves more. They just kind of
they're starting to train her a little bit, which is cool, and she's got the Wolverine claws.
Yeah, but they just kind of like throw her in, be like, hey, she links everybody else. Okay, there's this one scene that this kind of bothered me. Maybe some of you picked up on it too. There was a scene when Rosario Dawson is in telling Finn Jones, telling, you know, the Iron Fist that, look, I have a guy who fought against the hand.
Right.
And they just brush by it. And so if you're him and your whole life you've been taught that you destroy the hand, you kill the hand is this mythological thing that you've never seen before. Right. Somebody mentions, oh, my buddy fought the hand. It didn't end too well for him. They just move over it. Wouldn't he say, like, hey, who's your friend?
And let's call him.
Who's
and here's
your friend?
Actually, John Campia brought this
He's
up
He's down
earlier.
The street in Hell's Kitchen.
Big problem with the Netflix shared universe. It's not a shared universe because the one connecting point is Claire. And she should have called Matt Murdock
right away. Manhattan Island is not that big. It's a lot of people, but in terms of landmass, it's not that big.
Luke Cage is away. We get that from what happened in his series. Yes. He's indisposed at the moment.
Right.
Jessica Jones is mentioned by the one sister.
She hired him for
she had some problems drinking,
yeah.
So they give a little nod to her. But honestly, man, that was a big screw up where it's like you're not going to call Matt Murdock. Mm-hmm. Instead, you're going to get the female lawyer from Jessica Jones.
Yes.
It's like, no, Matt Murdock would be the obvious lawyer. So a lot of like strange things. It just seems like that doesn't make any sense.
And if they're doing like the full big true crossover in the Defenders, great. But in a lot of the Marvel movies, you have a couple characters that stop here and a couple characters that stop here, right? You could take Charlie Cox and put him in like, I don't know, 3 or 4 episodes. And he's like, listen, this is your fight. Mm. This is your fight to take.
Right.
If you need my help again, just call.
Or even a phone call scene where Claire calls him and he's like, you know, he's off doing something else. He's
I got a case. I got to help this poor couple out on something.
He's gone.
Yeah,
he's
gone. Right.
Doing something. Yeah. And the one thing we were talking earlier about Colleen Wing, again, a breakout series for her because every time she was on screen, amazing.
Good year for her. Game of Thrones last season.
Yeah.
Good year for her. Yeah, good year and a half for her.
When they talk, she and Madame Gao talk about her grandfather being a great warrior or something like that. They teased it so quickly. How cool would it have been to find out who he was, what he did, and like where she could draw power from? And he finally goes to like the other sect of the hand, which obviously, I will say, incredible casting for Hidoku.
Sure.
What was his name?
Bukoda?
He was great. I liked it. Very cool, calm, collected villain. Yeah, he was a good
nicely
villain.
Evil.
Yeah,
like, subtly evil.
As soon as he walked in the room, you're like, I don't trust the guy, right? Yeah. And rightly so. So he shows this awesome footage of a two-handed Iron Fist in like black and white footage taking people. And this thing I screamed, I was like, we're going to see two Iron Fists? Like, he's going to start doing this stuff?
Mm-hmm.
And then I know you said that you liked that he lost his chi. And I totally get that. The struggle is cool. But it goes back to, had we actually seen some Kun Lun stuff of his training, how we got the Iron Fist, how they were trying to teach him how to use it.
Sure.
And you're like, come on, dude, like center your chi. You've been there before.
Right.
yes, we got to the point where he finally punches the ground, and that scene was fucking awesome when he blew up that building.
Episode
that
13, really, though.
Episode yeah. 13. Yeah,
you got a little ways to get through it.
Episode 3, he punched a door. You know, like when they're
12 hours.
Yeah, 12 hours to get to this, right? You when he has that massive fight at the Hands compound and they're fighting everybody in Davos, like that was a really badass scene. But how much cooler it'd been if he had those Iron Fists going and they were attacking him with weapons and he was doing the Iron Fist and Davos was jumping off Iron Fists. Like there was so much more you could have been doing with the Iron Fists at those points.
You know, you bring up an interesting point. The main character, I think his name is Finn Jones, the actor.
Yeah, the actor. Yeah,
you know, he seems like a nice guy. I feel like the way he was portraying Danny Rand was a little bit too crybaby for me. Well,
John Campia said he was Kevin from Home Alone.
I was going to say he's Richie Rich with an Iron Fist. It was sort of like, I just didn't like the portrayal of his characterization in those first five episodes. Mm-hmm. I think he found his center. Like I was saying, like episode 6, he started to find, like, wasn't whining and crybaby about Rand and his parents and this and that. Right. He was more like, I am the Iron Fist. I'm on a mission.
Bakudo, sorry.
Once he finally got that mission statement in his mind and started doing it, I liked the character a lot more. Granted, a lot of people also were griping about his fighting style and how he looked like he didn't know how to fight. I feel like, yeah, there's a ton of stunt doubles in this movie, in this series. You could tell when it's not him all the time. I could always tell because this series doesn't have enough money to do face replacements. So you're like, oh, that's not him. But it doesn't really matter. I get it. I would like to see if they do. I mean, obviously, they've already shot Defender, so that's in the can. Hopefully, they did some more fight training with all these guys.
I just think they tried to make the show. I guess I shouldn't fault Marvel for this because a lot of the dramas right now, they're very serious. You know, after the whole era of Sopranos and The Wire, we got to make serious dramas, talk about serious adult things because most of the audience watching this are adults, you know, 15 on up to like 50, whatever, however old anybody is. But I think what they could have done is just taken a step back and it's like, this is Kung Fu. This is martial arts. There's a show on AMC right now called Into the Badlands. Mm-hmm. The plot's silly. It's ridiculous. But the martial arts is so much fun. It's just, it's crazy. It's over the top. It's not realistic. Just have fun. It's Kung Fu.
Well, that was like half the story of Crouching Tiger, Hidden Dragon.
Yeah, they're floating and jumping dancing on trees. And I mean, it's like, it's not going to be believable. It's their superheroes. Yeah. Let them be super.
I feel like this series was right on the verge of being something pretty dynamic. Mm-hmm. And they really, every time I thought something really badass was going to happen, it just went back to corporate litigation.
First time it happened was episode 4 is when the Hatchet Men finally showed up. And that was cool. Like when he was in the hallway.
I was like, we're getting our stairwell scene.
He was in the hallway with Joy, and all of a sudden the Hatchet, I'm like, yeah, here we go. This is the raid. Here we go. And then they start, but then you have to wait a few more episodes to get that back again. It would just
very pedestrian is a word I would use. Unfortunately, I hate using that word, but it's like the series as a whole is just not on par with all the other. And I thought Jessica Jones was way better. I think this is the weakest of them. And this isn't like, I'm not saying, oh, this is garbage, avoid it. I'm saying literally, seriously, do not watch the first five episodes. And you will really enjoy.
I think
you will enjoy Iron Fist immensely. No, I think the first five are so draggy. I was fast forwarding.
It's no wonder that critics were like, what is this?
I mean, and especially I had read and heard from friends about how boring the first couple episodes are.
Yeah.
And I was like, look, if you can't hook your audience in the first three episodes, your series is doomed. That's how I feel. Like,
well, I say it all the time on TV Talk. So Makuga test is if you can't, after three episodes, if you don't like it, you can bail.
Yeah, because the fourth episode is probably going to be more like the third episode. And if you didn't like it, because the first is the pilot, the second they're getting their sea legs, the third they're like, all right, we've got our story going.
Right.
If you're still not in, the rest of the series is not going to be pleasing. But for at least for me, I found enough sequences or scenes in those first five episodes where I was like, it kept me wanting to keep being bored out of my ass watching the rest of it. That's why I'd say watch the first, number one is the sixth one.
Joshua, can we talk a little bit about the family drama? I'm curious to see what you thought about. I thought the actress Meechums? Who played the Meechums, the actress who played Joy Meechum, Joy, she was incredible.
She was Jessica Henwick. Jessica Henwick is Colleen.
Yeah, she was on the Jessica CW 90210.
Jessica Stroop.
Now, I don't like her motivations at the end because she was accusing her brother of being like, you're violent, like you guys are killing people, this is bad. And then all of a sudden she's sitting with Davos at the end having some tea. And then he's like, well, we have to kill him. She's like, I'm listening. I'm like, oh, you're a murderer now.
Yeah.
You're fine with killing, you know, Danny Rand, your best friend. So like that kind of bothered me. But I thought she was incredible.
I thought definitely really felt for Joy, even though the scene when she's like, you didn't have him killed, did you? When he kills the guy from Rand, who's trying to take over the company from his kids. It's clearly obvious. Like, he didn't commit suicide. It's, you know, I mean, it's too friggin' convenient.
Right.
And she's too smart to actually buy that. Mm-hmm. But I thought she was great. I, of the whole thing, Ward Meacham, who we love from Banshee.
He's an incredible actor.
Incredible in Banshee. Yeah. I felt like his storyline was so sold short because he was just this patsy for his dad. And really and truly, he didn't have to do anything for the dad. He's just locked up there. Mm-hmm. Right. You know what I mean? And then the dad comes back.
Boromir's brother.
He comes back, and they're just like, oh, hey, Harold Meacham's back. Where you been, Harold? Like, no controversy. There's no press anywhere.
It was actually a repeat of the first episode where Danny Rand comes back. Yes. You're just like, he's wandering around looking at his building randomly. Like, am I seeing the same thing again with the dad? Yes.
We should try that when we go to New York and see if we can get an office building like
yeah,
that.
Yeah, really.
See
we should happens. Just all walk around listless, like, I don't know why I'm here for like 4 days.
Yeah. Here's the thing. I think if you're gonna weave these things together, right? You're gonna have this superpower guy from Kunlun with an iron fist tracking down the hand while also trying to be a part of his company again. Actually, make him part of it. Like he would go in there and be like, I don't know what's going on. I didn't go no schooling. And then he's like, well, the right thing to do here is like tell stuff to the press. That was cool, but it was like. He said something, and then he's on the cover of Time magazine. Like, there was no any kind of like corporate buildup. If you're gonna do it smart. Do it like you're gonna do it in real life. Press are gonna be everywhere. You're gonna be all over the television, all that kind of stuff. That is an easy write-in job. And all they did was like, Ward's like, he can't be Danny Rand. That's it. Oh, you get the company.
Yeah, and I also thought though, they should give the drugs to them for free. Yeah. It was all this like weird, like, yeah, you know. I get it. Everyone, that is right. That should be how it is.
At cost.
But then they made the actual corporation kind of like, oh, we're going to get rid of everybody. And it was like this weird kind of like, oh, none of this really matters.
It doesn't.
It felt like, oh, I'm just time wasting. None of this is going to come of anything. And none of it did. It was just like, this happens and then this. And it goes back to, you know, it's literally you're going back and forth when nothing
really happened.
It shows
what, like, this, the show's strength, again, should have just been. The martial arts aspect of it, his journey, his we should have gotten one episode that
all
talked about
Kunlun.
His
all
in Kunlun.
Yeah,
it's not. This is not Wolf of Wall Street. It's not Boiler Room. If you want to watch financial movies, watch Wall Street.
Yeah,
that's a good financial movie.
Obviously, nobody cares about Donald Trump and his stupid family. Right. You know, in real life, right now, no one wants to watch him go golf every weekend.
Right.
Nor do I care about these other rich billionaires playing around with money. It's like it's so boring.
It really
and
is.
Trite and uninteresting when you start focusing on it. Doesn't even matter about characterizations. Mm. You're like, oh, this is just gross.
There was one scene where Joy is walking and she sees Danny. She's like, oh, Danny, I thought I'd see you here. I'm like, where? On the corner of 5th and 8th? Like, he was just walking on the sidewalk. There was no building. There was no normal coffee shop that, like, oh, you know who we see here all the time? Danny Rand. No, he's just walking on the street.
Oh, man.
Here's the thing. In Luke Cage, I probably had like 3 or 4 like, yeah, moments. Like, this is awesome, right? Like a cheering moment. Mm-hmm. Daredevil seasons 1 and 2, cheering moments. Jessica Jones, a couple cheering moments. This one, I got like one half of a cheering moment when he finally punched the ground and blew up everything. And I'm like...
I cheered when she fought the main hand guy.
Oh, yeah, I'll give you that one, too.
During the Drunken Master sequence, there were a couple of couple of sequences where I was like, all right, this is moving along. It's starting to get its legs a little bit, then it would buckle. So
totally. It's like eating a carrot in between a donut, right? It's like this donut is delicious. Oh, the creamy center. This is fantastic. And then all of a sudden you're like, oh, there's celery and carrots for the next 35 minutes. Like
that's right.
You know, and we've been talking about it on TV Talk forever. That this is of all the people, I read Luke Cage comic books as a kid because I always liked the idea of just a strong dude that was bulletproof. Daredevil was, I know I'm in the super, super minority in this one, but I didn't hate the Ben Affleck movie. I thought it was actually kind of fun at points. I didn't like Elektra, okay? But this, I didn't know much about Iron Fist at all. I was never one of those kids that liked the like Kung Fu comics, right? I didn't like Bruce Lee, but I've always been a fan of martial arts. Love the Raid 2, that kind of stuff. I thought this was going to be the show where it was going to be like, wah-pa, 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 wah-pa. And then a lot of these fight sequences seem slow, like a lot of
bass.
You know, the Drunken Master one was really cool because that's how the Kung Fu is supposed to be, a hold, a pull, or that kind of stuff. The other ones, even in the compound, when he's fighting with Davos, there could have been some really cool, like, chop, pop, pop, pop.
Well, people will say, I'm sure they'll say this in the comments, everybody likes to come out and be like, they're martial arts experts, they're all like, you know, high-ranking guys, and they'll be like, you know, that's not how real martial arts is, no matter what study you're doing. And of course, I'm talking about movie and television martial arts. I'm not talking about going to the dojo and actually studying and centering yourself. I'm talking about just having fun on TV.
Right.
And I thought this could have had some fun. It just didn't have enough fun.
Yeah.
That was my biggest
It felt very serious all of the time.
Yeah.
He was always
Don't you think there could be one, both of you guys, there could be one character in the Defenders that isn't the dark, brooding guy? I know they all had tragedies. That's the kind of the crux of being a superhero. You're kind of like Spider-Man, Uncle Ben died. But you can still have that one character. Who's kind of, I thought this kid was going to be the kind of light, jovial kid of the
humorless.
Whole group.
They're all humorless and sullen and crybaby style. You know, I think Jessica Jones is probably going to be the one in the Defenders.
You think she's going to be the cracking jokes?
Okay. Yeah, I certainly hope so, because otherwise it's a bunch of sullen, dour, sour people like, now what do we have to do, fight the hand?
Yeah.
Boring. You know what I mean? It's like, I want to enjoy it, and I guess that's what, you just kind of nailed it. Iron Fist is kind of joyless.
I mean, they have a character named Joy, but the actual attitude of joy, the feeling of joy, is totally absent from this thing. Even when they're winning, it feels like they're losing.
Yeah. I mean, it definitely needs a little bit, not like cracking jokes, levity. That's not what we're saying. But like having joy in the fight scenes. That's something where it's like, you're absolutely right. A lot of the fight scenes were just kind of there. And it was always, oh, it's a procedural. Now we're moving forward. And then he's going to punch and jump off the window. And this, none of it had this kind of visceral excitement. Daredevil had a lot of sequences in it that were visually exciting.
Yes.
And this film series did not, unfortunately.
It felt like our only tie to the past was most of what Madame Gao was doing. Again, that's my favorite part of the show. Remember she was talking about how, was she like tortured? Something bad happened to her in the 1700s. Like, how old is she?
Yeah.
She's been on a long time. And I wish
a Madame Gao origin, even like a 20-minute origin of
Give her a little
Gao
mini. Give her three episodes. Give her a little miniseries. Who's her master? Yeah.
Well, remember the Daredevil second season, they got that tasty Kingpin episode.
Yeah, so good.
I mean, literally, Iron Fist is crying. If it ever got to a second season, I don't know if it will, because the reaction of this season.
We
got a Daredevil season 2-3 coming. We definitely have Defenders. I'm pretty sure they're going to be rocking.
Heroes for Hire, maybe.
Well, Jessica Jones is moving on to season 2. I would love to see a Heroes for Hire, and I would like to see what you're talking about a little bit more. I'd like to see Kun Lun for like an episode.
Yes.
Like, go back and give us all of that.
We just kind of missed. I mean, even when he was at that hand compound and he goes in that basement, he finds that they're tracking it, right?
Right.
There's never another mention of like who and why he's tracking, and he like throws a couple screens. He could have used the Iron Fist to just like crush, like punch a wall and like destroy it, like bring it to rubble. And here's the thing too, and I know that you talked about that you loved that he couldn't access the Iron Fist because he wasn't centering his chi. Well, had he actually been able to do some really impressive things with the Iron Fist leading up to that and then lose it, we would have realized how much more powerful of a weapon it was when he couldn't do it. Like, if he would have shown off a bunch of Iron Fisty kind of things. But to be honest, the entire series he's having trouble finding his Iron Fist, right? He gets the Iron Fist on Kun Lun. They never show any training of like how he's supposed to access his Iron Fist, what he's supposed to do, the devastation maybe in Kun Lun of the other guys being jealous that a white man got the Iron Fist, that he went through the training. And to be honest with you, because he was such a pouty kind of baby a lot of the show, the fact that he did beat this dragon, I didn't believe it. Yeah. Because he was never the guy in the room that you're like, that's a badass.
Well,
dude.
There were some times
or even like it was never revealed that it's like, oh, he's been confused and now he's become the Iron Fist.
Right.
He never actually became the Iron Fist in our eyes.
So. Oh, for sure.
Even like Davos, I'm like, yeah, Davos should be the Iron Fist. That guy's loyal.
Right.
He's intense. He's a diehard. He should be the Iron Fist.
He actually had like some funny moments. He's a really good actor. When he was making those little tinfoil ninja stars. And
that
then
was badass.
They just
used
those real quick,
yeah.
But still, like, showing some of the amazing things that you could do with the powers from Kun Lun would have been absolutely fantastic. Also, too, is, I'm getting so worked up about this because I was so excited about this series and I felt like we were just a little robbed.
The trailer was a little misleading.
Yeah, for sure.
It showed us a lot of the cool action sequences and, like, oh, this is really spaced out.
Yeah.
Right. Getting a lot of,
Had they actually taken, this Iron Fist character and made him just an absolute badass, like a cool dude. Mm. And he comes from Kun Lun. I know he comes from Damage Thing. I know his parents were shredded. But when you go and you have 15 years to sort of do it, the fact that he was like, he killed my parents, she killed my parents, they killed my parents, this kind of thing, we never believed that. And we kind of got teased with the Harold Meacham that like he did or didn't, whatever, that because he was so like brooding all that we kind of lost, that we actually cared about that.
Yeah, I lost interest in all of that by episode 9. I was more like, oh, just right now he's the Iron Fist and he's going after the hand, but there's a double hand going on. So there's like, that was more interesting than any of his crybaby past.
And you kind of got to hope that in the Defenders, Daredevils, they're all fighting, and Iron Fist is in the back going like, come on, work! It's like he needs Viagra. Yeah. It's like a guy, like, you know what I mean?
Honestly,
he can't get it up.
I'm sure that they fixed those problems. Like you said, it's different showrunners, it's different writers making the Defenders, so I'm hoping that they, like, combined their powers and were like, the people who didn't work on Iron Fist were like, nah, we're not doing any of that stuff.
Right.
We don't need any of those, like, lawyer scenes. We don't got to pad this out to 13 episodes. We got 8 tight episodes with all these characters in it. Let's have some fun.
Right.
So I'm still looking forward to Defenders and also all the other Netflix series.
For sure.
I'm just not looking forward to Iron Fist.
And I would say the one thing
two.
About, you know, if you're watching us saying that, you guys are being kind of harsh. Beautiful thing about television, it can change so quickly.
Oh, yeah. Totally.
Season 2 could be a completely different show. For hopefully, I know for some of you, maybe you loved it and you're like, I want the show to stay the same, but hopefully for me, maybe they for me get it back on track to having more balance, having more fun, more fight sequences. They can do that. Like, TV can change. It's not like a film that's set in place. You can just adjust.
You're
absolutely
right. And Heroes for Hire is what they should do. They should bring Luke Cage and Iron Fist together, have them be friends and working together. I think
you mentioned them as roommates.
Yeah. Well, Finn Jones is a good actor. I mean, I think also part of the problem is the scripting and the pacing of the series and what they were having him do. It's not like he can't be Danny Rand. He can't be Iron Fist. I think he just has to be given better material.
Yeah.
I agree. And I think we're all in the agreement on this panel that Netflix would benefit from 10 episode seasons.
They don't all need to be 13.
They don't. I mean,
but they're in that formula right now. So it's like, oh, we do 13. That's what we do.
Yeah.
Instead of being like, oh, we only have like 8. It's like,
well, then
just
I would, I would suggest breaking it down until like, because I thought Daredevil season 2 did it best with the first 4 episodes were the Punisher, and then the next 4 episodes were Elektra, but it wasn't. It should have been.
Right.
It should have been the next 4 episodes were Elektra, and then another storyline. They should try to get 3 storylines in each of their 13 episodes.
Right.
Well, we were in, too, before anybody says anything, because I know people are going to say, like, well, you guys review Arrow, Flash, you know, all the time. You guys don't say too much there. We had Mark Guggenheim, who's a showrunner for Arrow and Legends of Tomorrow, on here. We asked him which he preferred. You like the HBO FX
didn't
formula?
Didn't even flinch.
He didn't flinch. He's like, 13 episodes or less. 13 or less.
All
in a second.
Time.
And he works on 23 episode seasons.
Right.
And he even said, no, 13 or less immediately.
It's tighter.
It's hard for a writer. It's hard to write that much. That's a lot of writing for someone to do. It's hard. I give people credit who are showrunners. That's a tough job. You know, John, you're a creator. It's tough.
I think, I mean, going forward, listen, yes, we did kind of crush on Iron Fist a lot. Mostly, we're not trying to hate, but we're just trying to be honest about why we were disappointed, because we love this stuff so much.
Yeah, and I want to see more of it. I mean, honestly, anybody who's watching this who loved Iron Fist, I'm super happy for you, and I'm glad that you enjoyed it so much. I wanted to enjoy it way more than I did. I know people who hated it. I didn't hate it. I just found it to be lacking in a lot of things. I was able to get through those first 5 episodes that were painful to get to the next group of episodes, 6 through 13, which actually were a better storyline for me. Mm. I still could have done without all that, you know, lawyer, you know, bullshit about Rand, and I could care less about Rand Industries.
Because it didn't matter.
None of it mattered. Yeah. None of it. It's just like, oh, and here's, and also the scenes went on. Like this shot of me talking right now went on and on. It just was like, just shut up already. So move on.
Yeah.
There you go. All right. Well, we're going to talk a little bit about it also on Collider TV Talk, but this is our spoiler review for Netflix's Iron Fist. Well, next time you see us talking about TV altogether, it will be for the Defenders. Can't wait for that. Getting the whole crew together. David Griffin, before we leave, where can the good people find you?
You can find me on Twitter and Instagram at GriffinDE, as well as don't forget this Saturday, the season 3 finale of Star Wars Rebels is going to be upon us. So me, Christian, and Ken Knopsack, we're breaking that down. So be sure to check that out.
Beautiful. John Schnapp?
Well, you guys can find me on Twitter and Instagram, just at John Schnapp. Check out Collider Heroes tomorrow on Tuesday. We're going to get sweaty about Iron Fist, but we're not going to do spoilers. You can only check out those spoilers right here.
Right here, the spoiler review. I'm Josh McCuga. You guys can see me every Monday on Collider TV Talk, the Josh McCuga Show on YouTube. We love you guys. As always, put down the book, pick up the remote.
Hey guys, if you like this video, click the thumbs up button. Also, make sure you subscribe to our YouTube channel. It'll help you stay up to date with everything we've got going on here at Collider.